Hello everyone, and welcome to the session, the training session for General Assembly Plenary. Now, before we begin, please give us a heads up so we know that you are present by commenting your name below. So today we will be going through the committee, General Assembly Plenary, and we will be discussing the agenda a little bit on reforms in the Security Council. Please do comment your names below so we can know that we have enough audience, and then we can begin with this training session. Okay, so now we will be beginning. Before starting with the committee itself, it is important to know about the United Nations itself. So, as we are all aware, United Nations was something which was formed after the World War II. This was because the World War II proved the League of Nations to be a failure, and hence the United Nations was formed. The United Nations now has the main organs of the United Nations include the General Assembly Plenary. Now, I would like you all to answer this question, that what are the main organs of the United Nations? So, delegates, please comment so we know how well prepared you are for the biggest conference of IMN this year. Let us know in your comments below the organs of the United Nations. So to help you all, there are six main organs of the United Nations, one of them being General Assembly Plenary, which is being simulated and which will be discussing the agenda, reforms in the Security Council. The main organs, so to go into it, would be the Security Council along with General Assembly Plenary, the Trusteeship Council, which is now dormant. That is, this committee is right now not into the picture. That is, it is not an active committee. Apart from that, we have the International Court of Justice and the ECOSOC and the Secretariat. So these are the six main organs of the United Nations, five of which are active presently, and one, the Trusteeship Council, remains dormant at this stage. Now, General Assembly Plenary, being the most important organ, how do we determine, or this is because the Charter of the United Nations itself mentions General Assembly Plenary, that is, the chapter of General Assembly Plenary is mentioned first, the chapter of General Assembly is mentioned first in the Charter of the United Nations, thereby clearly signifying and emphasizing that General Assembly Plenary is one of the main organs, or one of the most important organs of the United Nations. When the United Nations was formed, it consisted of a number of members. If you all could let us know the number of members in the comments below. So we will wait for comments where you all will tell us that there are that when this United Nations were formed, how many members were there in the United Nations then. That is, how many members formed the part of General Assembly. Now, we would really appreciate that you all comment below, so it becomes like an interactive session and not a monologue. This will also help us to engage better. You can also ask questions in the comments, so we can answer those questions, and it will help us to help you in bettering your research. So, as you are commenting, there were 51 members, as you are rightly said, there are 51 members when the United Nations was formed. And all the members of the United Nations obviously form a part of the General Assembly plenary. And right now, we have exceeded to how many members, if you all could just let us know. How many members do we currently have in General Assembly plenary? So when the United Nations was formed, we had 51 members. However, today, as rightly said, we have 193 member countries who form a part of United Nations. So all these 193 member nations are a part of the General Assembly plenary, and they participate in all the sessions that take place into the General Assembly plenary. Apart from General Assembly plenary, as I said, we have the United Nations has various other other organs, those being the Security Council. Now the Security Council is also the most important organ. If you could let us know why it is the most important organ, the Security Council, and what is the significance of Security Councils over all other organs or all other committees of the United Nations. And why is it so important to discuss the reforms in the Security Council? What is the significance of the Security Council in the United Nations, and why is it important to discuss the reforms in the Security Council? As I said, kindly comment below so we know that you are participating and you have researched well. As you all are saying, the big five members and the veto power, that is correctly said, because the big five members and the veto power is something which is exercised in the Security Council. And the security, it is very important to note this point, that the Security Council is the only committee who can take decisions, who can pass sanctions. All other committees can only make recommendations to the Security Council. So even the decision to elect the Secretary General is done finally in the General Assembly plenary. However, the General Assembly plenary does it only after a recommendation is given from the Security Council. So you can understand how significant the role, there is a role of the Security Council. So also to note that General Assembly plenary has various, it is important to note the voting procedure which takes place in the General Assembly plenary. So for the same, the 2/3 of the members of the General Assembly plenary have to vote, or there has to be a consensus amongst 2/3 members of the General Assembly in order to pass a particular decision which has been taken. So this 2/3 majority, which is a simple majority, is required for all important issues, that is matters such as international peace and security and such. However, on ordinary issues, only a simple majority is required. However, the main issues regarding the peace and security, regarding any imposition of sanction, regarding introduction of new members to the introduction of any new members in the United Nations, all is done via a special majority. However, any other decisions are to be taken only via simple majority. Any questions that you all have till now? Now, please remember that General Assembly does not has more of a recommend. It gives a lot of recommendations. These recommendations can be on various fields, be it humanitarian, legal, political, social, etc. So the General Assembly can give recommendations on these various things. Similarly, for the election, one of the questions that we received is the election of the Secretary General. So for the election of the Secretary General, the General Assembly receives recommendations from the Security Council in order to elect the Secretary General. So you all can understand the importance of Secretary General. Now the various, in order to reach the agreement within the assembly, the Article 18 of the Charter of the United Nations, it enlists various provisions which incorporate the presence, the process of voting in the assembly. So every member of the General Assembly is entitled to only one vote. So however important the country may be, or however huge it must be in terms of its territory or in terms of its financial contribution, it only possesses one vote, that is only one vote per member nation. That is, all the 193 member nations have one vote in the General Assembly. Now again, in order to emphasize on what issues the General Assembly discusses, would require two-third majority. So these issues would be on the lines on recommendations in regarding to international peace and security, the election of the non-permanent members of the Security Council. So as you all must be aware, that the Security Council consists of 15 members, 5 being permanent and 10 being non-permanent members. So these non-permanent members are to be elected. So the election of this is something which the General Assembly takes care of. Also, the other organ of the United Nations is ECOSOC. So the election of the members of this particular organ, that is of Economic and Social Council, is also dealt via the General Assembly. Similarly, when the Trusteeship Council was in order, that is when it was active, the election of the members of the Trusteeship Council was also taken care by the General Assembly plenary. However, right now the Trusteeship Council is not working, that is, it is dormant. If any of you could comment what date or what year did the Trusteeship Council change its status from active to dormant? If any of you is aware that when Trusteeship Council stopped its functioning actively. So basically, Trusteeship Council was in order to see the transition of the various areas. The transition of them was taken care by the Trusteeship Council. So that from 1994, the Trusteeship Council stopped working, that is, it became dormant. That is, a month after the independence of this state called as Palau. So it became dormant. That was the last remaining United Nations trust territory. So exactly as you all are commenting, it was 1994 when this Trusteeship Council became dormant. After the last territory of the United Nations, last trust territory of the United Nations, it became dormant. So that was about the Trusteeship Council. So even the election of the members of the Trusteeship Council is something which is taken care by the General Assembly plenary. Post that, admission of any new members to the United Nations is also taken care of by the General Assembly. Then there are various sanctions that the United Nations can pose on the members. or there are any suspension of rights and privileges that the United Nations can pose on its members. So any issues related to that would also be taken care by this particular organ, that is General Assembly Plenary. Additionally, any budgetary questions of the General Assembly Plenary are also dealt via the United Nations. So all these above, issues, that is issues regarding international peace and security, election of members to the Trusteeship Council, which was previously done, election of members in ECOSOC, or admission of new members to the United Nations, or suspension of rights and privileges of the membership, along with considering the budgetary issues, are done via two-third majority of the General Assembly. Any other questions which does not fall under this would require only a simple majority of the United Nations, of the General Assembly Plenary. So any questions, if you all have up until now, you can let us know in the comments below, and we will try answering as many as possible during the time of this Facebook Live. And post that also, we will be answering questions. Now, coming to the agenda, so as you already answered, that when the United Nations was formed, it had 51 members. However, now we have 193 members. But previously, when the United Nations was formed and there were 51 members, the number of permanent members was 5. Now, after so many years, the number of permanent members has still remained the same, that is 5. So, after World War II, after the United Nations succeeded the League of Nations and it was formed, the people who won this war, the states who won this war, or who were the victors of this war, became obviously had an upper hand on the various other states. So, they gave themselves something called as veto power. Now, what is veto power? If anybody could explain. What a veto power is, because it is very important to understand the concept of veto power when we want to discuss reforms in the Security Council, because this forms one of the basic necessity for a reform today. Because it's not only that the 5 permanent nations are the one who are dominating the world, because there are various other nations who have come up in order to play an important role globally. Be it in the face of security or finance or economics or humanitarian issues, there are various other countries like Japan, Germany, Brazil, India, who play a very important role. So they are not given veto. The veto is kept with the 5 permanent nations, and it has not changed since so many years. Even when you see the first, when the total membership of the General Assembly Plenary was 51, however, now it is 193. When the membership was 51, the permanent members remained 5. And still, after the membership increasing to 193 member nations, the permanent membership still remains 5. So this calls for reforms in a great need for reforms in the Security Council. Now, regarding the reforms in the Security Council, there have been cases where reforms have been made in the past. One basic example was in 1965. In fact, this is considered as the only significant reform which took place, that is in the year 1965. If any of you could tell us what this reform was, that is the reform which took place with regards to the Security Council in the year 1965. So the question asked is, there have been reformed in the past, but what was the significant reform which took place in past in reference to the Security Council? To give you a hint, this reform took place in the year 1965. Exactly as you all answered, the number of members in the Security Council were increased. The number of non-permanent members in the Security Council were increased from 6 to 10. So previously, there were 5 permanent member states. These 5 permanent member states, if you all could let us know the 5 permanent member states of the Security Council in the comments below. So the question is, who are the 5 permanent members of the Security Council? The question being, who are the 5 permanent members of the Security Council? That are the 5 states which hold permanent membership in the Security Council. Rightly said, these are USA, UK, China, France, Russia. So these are the 5 permanent members of the Security Council. So these have been holding permanent membership in the committee since the inception of the United Nations. And even after so many years, there have been reforms which have increased the non-permanent membership, however, the permanent membership has remained the same. So first, membership of the Security Council was such that there were 5 permanent members and 6 non-permanent members. However, with the reforms in 1965, or with reference to reforms which was done in 1965, the non-permanent members increased from 6 to 10. So this was a reform which was done in 1965, and it is important for the delegates in this committee to note this down, because this would be a very important important change with regards to the history in the reforms in the Security Council. Post this, in 1992, the Secretary General was Boutros Ghali. So he again brought up the topic of the reforms in the Security Council under the agenda, an agenda for peace. So this is another significant landmark which took place and which you must be well researched in, which happened in 1992, where Boutros Ghali was came up with this concept of an agenda for peace, which was called an agenda for peace for the reforms in the Security Council. So this was basically in reference to restructuring the composition of the Security Council. For all of you are asking this question, it would be in 1992, the Secretary General post was held by Boutros Ghali. So he brought up this topic of reforms in the Security Council with reference to the restructuring the composition of the Security Council. This was called as, or this was put under, this was given as a term as an agenda for peace. So an agenda for peace, this is something that Boutros Ghali introduced in 1992 when he became the Secretary General for the United Nations. So regarding this, you must be well researched about this concept. Also, one more another thing which took place in 1992 was that Japan and Germany, they came up to be the second and third largest financial providers to the United Nations. So, being the second and the third largest providers, finance providers to the United Nations, they also demanded that they must be given a permanent seat in the Security Council. Similarly, Brazil and India also gained important roles in globally. India being the second largest country, it also it became important in order to give these countries a greater role in the Security Council. Now, all of you are asking various questions regarding the IIMAN rules of procedure. So, this is not a training session for IIMAN rules of procedure. This is a training session for the delegates of the General Assembly plenary participating in IIMAN USA. As with regards to the IIMAN ROP, the training session you will be notified for the training sessions regarding the IIMAN ROP. Now coming back to our agenda, in 1992, so these were the two significant landmarks that took place in the year 1992, wherein the then Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Boutros Ghali, came up with this term, an agenda for peace, in relation to restructuring the composition of the Security Council. This was an important landmark in order to again bring forth the topic of reforms in the Security Council. Secondly, the countries like Japan and Germany, they gained important positions globally, since they were providing the largest funds to the United Nations, or we can say they were the second and the third largest financial contributors to the United Nations respectively. Japan being the second largest contributor and Germany being the third largest contributor to the United Nations respectively. Also, Brazil and India also gained important positions globally, since Brazil was the fifth largest country in terms of territory, and as we all know, India is the second largest country in terms of population. So, since both of these countries have played a greater role globally, be it through their population or through their territory, so they made significant contributions. All these four nations made significant contributions globally. So, in 1992, they clubbed to form a group of nations called as G4, which now demanded a permanent seat in the Security Council. So, from 1992 to today, 2017, these four groups, called as the G4 group of nations, fight for a permanent seat or demand a permanent seat in the Security Council, because they contribute as much and they play a very significant role in globally. So, and hence, there is a demand for reforms in the Security Council and them getting a permanent seat. Now, if you all, I hope you all understood what the G4 group of nations are. If you all could comment below about comment below the countries who are the G4, who form the G4. So the question is, which are the countries which form the part of the G4 group of nations? So we expect you all to comment. We understand whether you have understood this concept well or not, or whether you would like us to explain it again. So, the question being, which are the countries included in the G4? or the what is the interest group called as the G4? What are the countries included in that? So again, I shall be repeating about the countries or the group of nations who are included in G4 and what is their significance. So since 1945, there were only 51 members who were the part of the United Nations, where in the Security Council, five being the permanent members who would exercise veto power, and six being the non-permanent members. Now in 1965, a reform was made in order to increase the number of non-permanent nations. So then the number of non-permanent nations increased from 6 to 10. However, the number of permanent nations remained 5. Now, coming to 1992. In 1992, the then Secretary General of the United Nations, Boutros Ghali, he introduced this concept in order to push the agenda of reforms in the Security Council. His motive being reforming or restructuring the composition of the Security Council, that is restructuring that there are only 5 permanent nations even after so many years after the United Nations is formed, and there being only 10 non-members, although the membership from 51 had increased. Also, the other significant change, but other significant thing that came to global perspective in 1992 was that Japan and Germany, they were the second and the third largest contributors, financial contributors to the United Nations. So obviously they had an upper hand as regards to the other members. And they also gained they started demanding a permanent seat in the Security Council. Similarly, Brazil being the fifth largest country in terms of territory, and India being the second largest in terms of population, also started demanding a permanent seat in the Security Council. So these four nations together were called as a G4. So this interest group, namely Japan, Germany, Brazil and India, together are called as the G4 nations, and these G4 nations would want a permanent seat, or they are pushing for reforms in the Security Council with special reference to increasing the permanent membership along with veto in the Security Council. So even today, these four nations are pushing forward for a permanent seat in the Security Council. Now again, in order to emphasize the significance of veto. So veto is something wherein a veto is, as already discussed, it is exercised by the P5 nations. The P5 nations being the permanent nations, namely USA, UK, Russia, China and France. So these P5 nations have the power of veto, wherein whenever there is a decision, and even one of these P5 nations veto it, that is they go against it, that particular decision will not be passed, or that particular decision is not stalled. So in order for a decision to pass, however important it must it is globally, and even if one of the members of the P5 nations has vetoed it, that particular decision or that particular issue will not be passed, even if all the other 15 or all the other 14 members have given their consent. So this is about the G4 nations. Now against G4 nations, their regional there were other states who were not against the concept which was proposed by the G4 nations. Now this group was called as a coffee club or uniting for consensus. So they now created, so they would not want an increase in the permanent nations, but they would want an increase in the non-permanent membership of the Security Council. So this was majorly led by Italy, Pakistan, Mexico and Egypt. So these four particular states formed the coffee club, which was against the G4, the interest group that is represented by the G4 nations, who would want the permanent membership in the Security Council. Against this, other group of nations called as a coffee club or uniting for consensus, represented by Pakistan, Mexico, Italy and Egypt, was formed. They did not want an increase in the permanent membership. However, they were propagating for an increase in non-permanent membership in the Security Council. Now, if you all could let us know the nations who were represented by G4 and Coffee Club, because these are the two important blocks which would be coming in the committee. So these are the two kinds of blocks which will be formed, and that is how your research should be followed. So any questions that you all have regarding G4 and P5 and their stand, you all can let us know. Also adding to it, there was another seeing the G4 and the Coffee Club, the African countries also came together. So the African countries also wanted a permanent seat or a voice in the Security Council. Now the rationale behind this being that the African countries, as everybody knows, is they have faced a lot of atrocities in the past, or there are various issues, international issues relating to the African countries. Also, it is important to give these countries regional representation. So in order to ensure regional representation, the group of African countries started voicing their opinion for two permanent seats in the Security Council. That is, they would want two permanent seats to always be there in the Security Council, and then the African countries, the various African countries on a rotational basis could take up those two permanent seats. So along with G4, along with the Uniting for Consensus, that is the Coffee Club headed by Italy, Pakistan, Egypt and Mexico, which formed the Coffee Club, there were a set of African countries who came in order to voice their opinion for two permanent seats, in order to ensure that they are given proper regional representation in the Security Council, and they get veto power in order to ensure that their voice is heard, because a lot of issues that internationally are being faced are concerned with these African countries. So this was in regards to the various bloc positions which are related to reforms in the Security Council. Now, it is important to ensure that that there are various topics under the reforms in the Security Council that one needs to take care of. So these various topics, first, as we've been discussing, would be the veto power. That is that even after so many years, after the United Nations has passed and the member nations have increased from 51 to 193, only 5 nations have been given the veto power. So that should be rectified. So this was in regards to veto power. The second big reform that would be the membership in the membership composition of the Security Council. That is, whether there should be an increase in the membership of the Security Council, the non-permanent members, whether they should be increased, whether there should be a more regional representation, as in the case of Africa. So that is another reform which would be included in this particular agenda, apart from a discussion of the veto power. Then coming next would be the appointment of the Secretary General. Now, this was something which I briefly covered while we started the agenda, is that for the election of the Secretary General, it is that the Security Council gives a name as a recommendation to the General Assembly Plenary, and then the General Assembly Plenary has to act upon the recommendation of the Security Council. So in that case, this is something which needs reform, because it is the General Assembly Plenary cannot act without the recommendations of the Security Council with regards to the appointment of the Secretary General. The fourth and one of the most important thing is that which is of concern while discussing reforms in the Security Council would be with reference to the working methods of the Security Council. Now, working methods is a very broad topic, and it is important that you all research well on the working methods. One such method would be the closed-door meetings of the Security Council. So, closed-door meetings are something which usually are called by the P5 nations and are not officially recorded anywhere. So, these closed-door meetings form a significant part of the decision-making, wherein a lot of important decisions which affect global scenarios and are taken upon in the form of closed door meetings. That is, so there is an urgent need in order to reform the working methods of the Security Council. Now, this was something which was also taken up in 2005 by Kofi Annan, wherein he emphasized on the working methods of the Security Council and the open-ended working, and he mentioned something about the open-ended working group. So all these form various important agendas under reforms in the Security Council. So in order to sum this up, if you all have any questions, you all can write it down and we will be answering them all even after the live video has ended. But in order to sum up, it is important to know the previous reforms, such as that which took place in 1965, the important role that Guthros Bali played in 1992 when he introduced the term an agenda for peace and pushed for reforms in the Security Council. Similarly, when in 2005 Kofi Annan mentioned about the open-ended working groups, this was something which is to be taken care of while researching or going through the agendas of the Security Council. Now, while we understand the various, there are various other reforms also which are to be taken care. However, the four main reforms would be in terms of first being the veto power, secondly being the representation or the restructuring the composition of the Security Council, then being the appointment of the Secretary General, and again, as I mentioned, the working methods, the various working methods of the Security Council would be something which we can discuss mainly. Also, the other things would be the relationship between UNSC and UNGA is something which would also be discussed under reforms in the Security Council. So, if you all have any questions regarding this, you all can let us know in the comments below. After the live video has ended, we will be answering to all your questions. Thank you for attending, and please comment below in the questions. We will try to answer those as many as possible. Thank you.